Hey YouTube, how you doing? Thanks for hanging out. It's gonna be a Continental GT650 today, my trusty Royal Enfield, which I'm having fun on. I'm still trying to break it in. Got a few more 100 miles to go, maybe about 400. Should be there pretty soon. In the meantime, made a couple of minor changes. I got this seat. Now, the sharp-eyed viewers are gonna say, hey, dude, that looks just like the original seat. And actually, it does look just like it, other than this little tag that says Touring. What that means is, I'll show you the original seat. It's in the, I put it in the box that the new seat came in. The difference is, this original seat, quite a few people complain about it. It's a little soft, and I agree. I ride 30 miles one way to work, and about halfway there, my rear end is killing me. I'm just sinking in to the pan, I guess, just about. Yeah, I don't know if you can see in these holes, but you just see how you just see the yellow foam? Not yellow snow, because you wouldn't want to do that. But the yellow foam, well, on this new seat, I'm not going to bother taking it off, because I believe you're all smart enough to understand. But if you looked underneath this in those two holes, you'll see this white mesh that is sitting over that foam. I don't know if it's just the mesh, but the seat is definitely a bit firmer, not a lot. Somebody said like 30%. I'd have to agree with that. What that foam does, I think, stiffens things up a bit. It's also supposed to kind of keep your rear end cool. Now my rear end is really cool. I don't know about yours, but every little bit helps, I guess. I like it. It's all right. I've been riding with it for the last 2 days. Definitely firmer. One thing I noticed, though, is because it is firmer, I'm not sinking in as much. Side effect of that is I'm kind of feel like I'm sloping forward as I'm sitting on the bike. You see how this thing has a ever so slight lift? So I feel like I'm sliding forward. Yeah, so it's a little give a little, take a little. All that being said, the snafu here was, the reason I bought this seat was because I wanted to put a really cool seat cowl on the back that would make it look like a solo seat. And then if I ever wanted to take a passenger, which quite honestly I don't, but in case I did, that cowl would bolt on here into these screw holes. And then if I ever want to take a passenger, I just pop it off. And then I have a passenger seat. So in chatting with people online, they mentioned that the Continental GT535 seat cowl, which I really love the look of, which is right here, that was a direct fit. So now to me, let me see if I could do this one-handed. This is what a seat cowl should look like. It's got some height to it. It's got a little back pad. Are you dizzy yet? You're like, why didn't you set all this up before? Because, dude, we're hanging out. That's why. So, that's the idea. I love the shape of it and that little backrest, but unfortunately it doesn't fit. So I spent 90 something bucks on that. And while that was coming here all the way from India, I figured, well, the stock seat doesn't, it's not comfortable. Let me get a replacement touring seat. So that was another 100 and, I don't know, 15, 20 bucks. So I'm a couple hundred bucks in the hole right here. That shows up, looks great. Doesn't fit. And then a couple days later, that shows up. So what's my solution? Spend more money. Royal Enfield makes a solo seat that has it's a little teeny tiny cowl, and then the rear loop is exposed. I really don't like the look of it that much, but I definitely like it better than just having that flat stock seat. I may end up trying to sell that, but what I do want to do sometime in the near future, I want to try and fabricate a seat cowl that looks like that, but out of metal, probably aluminum, and make it the right dimension so it actually does fit on this seat. So then this way I can have the solo seat from Royal Enfield, and then I can also make my own rear cowl and have some fun doing that, something to videotape, etc. Okay, I'll let you know when that happens. In the meantime, today, here's what we're doing. Got these stock levers. They're just regular old levers. I find I have to reach a little more than I want to. Well, I found these beautiful adjustable levers on eBay for an amazing price. They're like 25 bucks. They have a good weight to them. They're CNC aluminum. The nice thing about these two is the more expensive ones I've seen are all black. My bike, as you've seen, is chrome and black, so these match the look a lot better for my taste. For anyone that doesn't know, these have an adjustable lever here. As you click that lever, as you click this adjustment lever, this lever will get closer and or further away from the handlebar to suit your taste. Plus, I think they look really neat. Here's a side-by-side. So there's your stock lever, and then there's your new lever. Little dog leg brings a little closer too. So I'm gonna go ahead and install those today. Let's do it. Be right back. Yeah, I figured I'd stop being lazy. So this is the new seat. I popped it off. Can you kind of see that white mesh in there? See it right there? Oh, hang on, Obi-Wan Kenobi was just talking. Oh, Chewbacca had something to say too. Anyway, so that white mesh in there, you can kind of see it. That's how you know that you have the touring seat. Not just from the snazzy little touring label. Alright, so for anyone questioning whether they're the same seat or not, they're not. Alright, be back. Alright, I'm going to start with the brake lever because it appears this will be the easier of the two. The clutch side, I'm going to have to slacken up the clutch cable. But on this side, it looks like I just need to remove this pivot pin. So let's get started. First, underneath there's a 10 millimeter nut. That's got to come off carefully. Not fitting well on there with the thing. Let's go this way. There we go. Screwdriver. This nut just holds the pivot pin in place. I believe it also, the pin itself screws into the perch here, so it's just kind of more a safety feature. There is a switch back inside there that this lever pushes up against. You just got to be careful not to hurt that in any way. So you got that, you got this, you can see it's got some grease and stuff on it. So I'm just going to clean this pin and re-grease it, and that's your switch for the brake light. That's got a dab of grease on it as well. And this kind of, this little bowl-shaped notch sits right over that. So let me go clean this stuff up and then re-grease it and come back. Alright? Alright, I cleaned this all up. Put a little dab of grease in there. Grease the pin up. Now I'm gonna put it back on. Hopefully it's as easy as it seems. I grabbed a new screwdriver that fits that screw head a little bit better. I don't think it's in yet. Nope. There we go. There it is. There it is. Nice and easy. Feels good, feels solid, it's clicking like it's supposed to. All right, just gotta put the nut on the bottom. That felt a little weird. Not sure why. I think it's okay. It just felt a little odd going on. I don't have to kill this. It's just to kind of make sure that this pin doesn't rotate out. Now some guys have talked about this up-down movement like that. Personally, I don't really care about that too much. And if I find that it does cause me any problems, at some point I can try and stick fiber washer in there or some sort of thin nylon washer. But I really don't mind. All right, on to the clutch lever. The trick here is I have to slacken the cable enough to feed it out of there to get this handle off. I want to see if just loosening it from here is enough. If not, then I have to come down to the case here and loosen it here and then readjust it later. The first step though, I just want to show you before I do it. There is a switch right over here, and I'm not sure that I absolutely have to. Where are you? There you are. Where is it? Right there. Okay, it's got these two little screws. That's I believe it's a cutoff switch, so if the bike is in gear you can't start it unless you pull in the clutch. I'm gonna remove it. I've been told if you don't, you could break it when you're removing this handle. I don't quite believe that, but better safe than sorry. So let me hook you up on the tripod. You don't necessarily have to see me removing that, but at least you'll know what I'm doing. All right, so let's get at it. Hey, sorry about that. The post lady showed up and actually brought me some goodies that I ordered for this bike. Let's see. Hey, check that out. I've been looking for something like this for a while. Popped up on a page I'm on. And did some digging. Look at that. Hopefully they'll fit. It's a universal, where are you? God, I'm not getting good at this. Universal fork shield. Rather than a gaiter, it'll fit around the fork leg and then sort of protect any dirt and dust getting in there. So we'll check that out in a little while. Okay, let's get back to it. All right, here I was. Little screws, just taking my time. I don't want to break anything because that would suck big time. Alright, that came out now. I'm not sure if it just pulls out now or what. I'm not sure. But I'm going to move on and get back to it. Oh, I had mentioned in a previous video the Japanese industrial standard. That's one of the tips right there. I don't know if you can make that out. It looks just like a Phillips, but the angle here is different. I don't necessarily need to be using that on this bike. I just grabbed it. Plus, also, that's a magnetic end, so it helps hold the screws on. All right. Wish me luck. That's a smaller than a 10. That's an 8. That's a 10. I'll be right back. Let me grab an 8 millimeter. All right. Let's see. Now I'm just going to take this bottom nut out. I'm not going to remove the top bolt, the pivot bolt yet, because I want to see if I can slacken up that cable to get it out first rather than after, because I've tried that in the past with other bikes and it just becomes a headache. So how are we doing here? Good. All right, so that's off. Now I just want to take a quick measurement of this gap so I can put it right back there after, if I need to. Well, that's tight. That's really tight. Hang on, I'll be right back. All right, don't try this at home. I'm gonna use the channel locks, but very gingerly grab it. I'm not gonna clamp down on it. Just enough to spin it. So when you screw that in, it should make this cable more slack. And it might be just enough to where I can pull it out. And if I can line up these gaps here. All right, let's see. I think that might have done it. Unscrew that. And again, I got to be careful of that switch. I'm not exactly sure what the deal is, because now that I've unbolted it, I've never had to do that before on any other bike, but I've mentioned to you guys that I've never actually worked on a Royal Enfield, so everything's a little bit different, you know? As similar as they are, there are slight differences, so you always kind of want to take your time rather than risk breaking something. And also, like, I went on YouTube and looked this up, so I'm not the first guy to do this, duh. But it doesn't hurt to get information, just like reading the manual, and what have you. Alright, that's all greased up too, just like the other one. Put that aside. And then I've got that. Huh. I don't want to force it at all. Let's see how that switch needs to come out. Hopefully I'm not speaking too soon. So ideally I would pull that out, but it looks like it's not quite enough. So I'm going to have to loosen it on that end. I think that's a 12. You want to come with me? You want to check it out? How's that? Better? You happy? You happy? Let me double check. Yeah, I think that's a 12. All right. I'm just loosening that up. I'm not used to this type of adjuster, actually. But now I am. My motor's a little hot because I rode earlier today. So I'm just going to push that forward and release that. I'm going to try and not turn that if I don't have to, but I'm probably going to have to because I haven't really changed much. So here we go. Let me bring it back around. Don't get dizzy. Hang on. There we go. So now I can pull that out. There's a little rubber doobob in there. Let's see if I can push it out like this without damaging it. There it is. Doobob, come out. Like that. And let's see about that switch now. There we go. So that's out. You know, I don't think that switch needed to come out. You just have to be careful. This has grease and other lovely things on it. My cable. Feels alright. Greased. There's just some grease in there. Want to clean out. Right there. I'd like to try. I don't have a cable luber, unfortunately, but I'm going to do my best and get a little lithium grease in there, at least in this spot. Work that in and out. Get some on the cable. I'm going to do that to the other side as well. It doesn't hurt. All right. So now I'm gonna clean up the pin here of the grease that's on there, and I'll just re-grease it with some fresh grease. Now mind you, it's a new bike, all that's new and fresh and what have you, but no sense in not just doing it. Just taking a look at that switch again. It is real small, you have to be careful, but I think we'll be okay. The main thing I want to do is make sure that these are similar. Quick glance, they look close. You see how this has a, this sticks out and this does not. I don't think that'll be an issue. These are made specifically for this bike, but we will find out, won't we? All right. Oh, hang on. I also want to put I put a little grease right in there and on the pin that's going to go through there. I also want to put just a dab in here where the clutch cable, the head of it's going to sit. It's got a, this particular one has a plastic sheath over it. Can you see that right there? But again, this doesn't hurt to do. I'm gonna pop that on. There we go. Put that in place. Be careful of that switch. Now, I also don't want to kink the cable at all. Interesting. Let's try it this way. Yeah. Because that's gotta, hang on. I heard the switch engage, so that's good. That's in place. The switch is in decent shape, it seems. All right, put the pin in. Careful. Let's see here. Okay, looks like you grab so I can use my wrench, tighten it down. There we go. Excuse me, I have the hiccups. You with me? Sorry, I'm a little quiet today. Okay, that's on. Still have to put the nut on the bottom, but I'm going to leave it like that for the moment. I hear the switch engaging, so that's good. I'm going to now take you back to the future. Don't get dizzy. We'll tighten that up. So, first, pop that rubber back on because I popped it off. That goes on there. Now, technically, all I should have to do is tighten this nut because I didn't move that one. So that's what I'm going to do. And let's see if that works. Can you see? Is my big old head in the way? Oh, by the way, usually I have my garage door closed. Today I have it open. So you might hear more road noise. Or like before the mail lady came by. Let's see. Alright, now I'm happy with that. Just give it a quick, one last snug. You don't want to kill it, just these two nuts help it from loosening. And now, bring it back here. Can you see? You can't. But I will make it so you can. There we go. First thing I'm going to do is put those two little screws back in for the switch. Camera shut off, sorry. I was saying, I have to be honest, sometimes it's a real pain in the rear end. Because you can't see through the glasses, they slip, you can't get close enough, whatever. But it's just a natural part of getting older. It just is what it is. Oops. That's on. That's on. Don't at all have to kill it. Oh, at this point, I'm going to put the nut back on the bottom, too. No need for it to stay off. I'll show you one thing about my glasses though, which does help. Let me just get this on here. If you look, they're bifocaled, see? But I don't need these to see far. It's all for seeing close. So the big part of the lens, it's like a regular reading glass, where usually that's arm's length. And then the bifocal part is even closer, so I can get about maybe a couple feet away from something and be able to see it. So that's for close and closer. Works out really well. I recommend it to anybody that does need glasses, reading glasses, to work with. It makes it quite a bit easier. All right. The last thing should have is to unscrew this to where you're supposed to just have about 2 to 3 millimeters of play here. I think that's that. And if I tighten that down and measure it, I'm curious to see if it's in the same spot it was in. Ha, exactly. Exactly in the same spot. And I see it moving on this side, on the clutch case. So, I also have the vertical up-down movement. But I don't think that's going to be a problem. All right. I like that. All right, that's that. I think they look great. Super easy, inexpensive, And now the bike looks even better. Can get that up and down, but it's really not a big deal. All right, that's that. Shall we go on to the fork covers? Let me get them out of the package, take a look at them, show you what we got. All right, I'll be back. I just went forward and attached these. It's really not much to it. It was just a plastic. This shield here, kind of half moon shaped, and then underneath is a piece of rubber, and then a zip tie. A little chintzy with the zip tie, but it's okay. I'll look past it. What I really like is that I've got these kind of more modern looking shields, guards, keeps dirt and dust from hitting right in the front there and possibly getting into your fork seal, making it leak. And what I really like is I didn't have to disassemble the forks from the triple trees to put them on. Most of these, you have to disassemble the forks and then slide the fork tubes out and slide those on and then put everything back together. So I'm willing to have a little bit of a zip tie nub sticking out to make up for the ease of installation. And I think it's a little bit of a modern look to this modern retro bike. So that's it for today. Beautiful day here in New Mexico. Temperatures in the about 90. Great day for riding. But for now, I'm gonna put all my stuff away. Got the old levers here. I'm saving everything I take off, and I'm gonna keep it somewhere in good shape, because somewhere down the line, like 20 years from now, when I'm older and grayer, this may all be kind of like how now we're all chasing after KZ900 parts and Honda CB750 parts, etc. You know what I'm saying? So that's it for today. Have a great one. Enjoy. And see you soon. Bye.